Today I'm going to talk about programming with Socket IO. This is the title of the talk. So a little bit about me. So I'm one of the founders at Hashcube. Hashcube is a gaming company. We make games primarily on Facebook. The popular game that we have right now is Sudoku Quest. That's our main focus right now. We primarily work on PHP, JavaScript and CSS. Games are not Flash. They work on the browser and they use HTML and CSS. I've been a fan of JavaScript. I've taken a liking to JavaScript very recently, primarily because of the advent of networks, frameworks like Backbone and Socket.io. So I like JavaScript a lot, and front-end also too. So we do a lot of that also at our company. Okay, and the other thing is, I would be a little fast probably, so if I'm very fast or if I'm too low, let me know. And if there are any questions, please feel free to interrupt. Okay. So this is like a personal thing why I started Socket.io. So there was this game on Facebook called Tetris Battle. So it's a multiplayer game. So I'm on the left side and I play with somebody else on the right side. So what happens is it's a Tetris game. And whenever you clear lines, you send those lines to the other person and they start built up. So this is like a real-time game that they develop. But this is primarily on Flash, and we don't use Flash. We are using HTML and JavaScript. So we wanted to introduce multiplayer functionality within our games, and the answer for that was Socket.io. So one of the reasons why we started exploring Socket.io and doing that. So a little bit before that, so before I go into details about Socket.io, so this is how the traditional web has been. So how many of you are JS developers? Okay, so the traditional web has been a request response kind of scenario. So we have a server on the client. So it's usually a case where the client requests for data and the server responds for the request. And that's how web has primarily been. And there is no way for the server to send data to the client. There is no way for the server to push data to the client. It is only possible for the client to request data and the server then responds to that response back. So that's how it has always been. But games are very popular and real-time apps have become very, very popular. And with this kind of architecture, it doesn't really help a lot. But there have been some solutions to solve this problem. So some of the popular ones have been Comet. Comet is actually an umbrella term for a lot of technologies. So what they do is they use something called long polling. So what happens is the client keeps the connection open between the client and the server. And since the connection is open, the server can send data to the client whenever there is data to be sent. And after some time, the connection is closed and again reset. So this is how long polling happens. So a long connection is kept between the client and the server, and then whenever the server wants to send data to the client, the server sends the data back to the client. So that is one of the ways in which push was implemented. And obviously Flash is also one possible way. So you open a socket connection between your browser and the server. Since the browser will have a plugin, a Flash player installed, and you can have a socket connection between that and the server. But these two don't really work well for multiple reasons. So Comet is just a workaround for making real-time communication. But Flash is entirely a different story because obviously it doesn't work well on mobile devices. Apple doesn't support it. The future may not be Flash. So these don't scale very well. So that's when WebSockets got introduced. So as the name suggests, they are sockets for the web. So one other problem with Comet and those kind of technologies is even though they are present, they have a lot of overhead. So for every connection between the client and the server, there are a lot of HTTP headers passed around. And it's actually a lot of waste of bandwidth and resources. So to overcome this overhead, WebSockets was introduced. So it is a new standard. So it provides bidirectional and full duplex connections. So both the client can communicate to the server as well as the server can communicate to the client. And full duplex means they can happen at the same time. Communication between the client and the server can happen at the same time without collision. So one thing with WebSockets is they are not implemented everywhere. Only the latest browsers have WebSockets in them. Yeah. But WebSockets is an evolving standard and it looks very promising. Okay. So now Socket.io is a library. It's one of the libraries that implements WebSockets. So Socket.io is actually a very good library. It's an awesome library. It has a simple API interface to interface with WebSockets, as well as the other thing about Socket.io is it supports multiple browsers. It even works on IE6. So the way it works on IE6 and other browsers is, so it tries to use WebSockets. If it doesn't support it, fall back to other transports that are available in on the browser. So it could fall back to Flash. So if IE has Flash installed, then it can fall back to Flash. Or it can even go to long polling. It's nothing but AJAX request, which keeps the connection open between the server and the client. That is one other way in which this can happen. So it keeps on falling back to whatever transport is available. There are like 6 different transports, XHR multipart, JSONB polling, and other stuff. So Socket.io is one good library with a simple API interface. It's also open source. A lot of companies are actually using it. So this is just a simple introduction to Socket.io. If you have any questions until this point, please ask them.
Okay.
So let's jump into demo. So the demo program that I wrote it's a very simple game. So it's a multiplayer game that we all usually play as children, as kids. It's a very popular game. So the game is this, you actually have to connect the dots. It's a two-player game, it's a turn-based game. So you connect the dots and okay, so the way it works is you connect the dots and you form squares. So whoever owns the maximum number of squares actually wins the game. So I can actually show you a demo. So the way it works is I form a line, the other person makes a move. So once I close this box, I own this one. So you get the idea. So this actually has been built over Socket.io. This is a simple demo that I created. So you see that it is real time and it uses WebSockets because I'm using Chrome. But based on what browser you use, it actually also works on other browsers. I can show you a demo on other browsers where WebSockets are not supported and still see how it works. So this is the basic game that I'm going to demo about, and just dive into the code. So I use a bunch of things. So I use Express. Express is another framework that is very popular. It is used to create a very.
Does Socket
work
on top of Node.js?
Yeah, it works on top of Node.js. So what we basically do is we start a server and I listen on port 81. So port 81 is the one I listen on. So that's when it starts accepting it accepts connections on port 81. We'll just skip this part for now and then I'll come to it later. So this is the part where you actually listen for connections. So you actually wait on this connection event, and whenever a client connects to the server, this part of the code gets executed. So it's IOR socket for all of connection. And there are three built-in events that Socket IO supports. One is connection, disconnection, and something called message. So these are the three built-in ones. But apart from that, you can actually create your own custom events. So connection, disconnection is obvious. Whenever a client connects, it's connection. Whenever a client disconnects, it's disconnection. And message is when you want to send a message. So the API, if you look at it, is actually very simple. And register is a custom event that I have created. So whenever a client connects, it has to register with a nickname or something like that. So that's what the register is. And once registration happens, we actually start the game. So it's that simple. So I'll just quickly go through the code. So this is the register part. This is the message part. And then the disconnect part. So in the register part, what I basically do is, whenever a client connects, I put him into a queue. And when the next client connects, I put him again in the queue. And I take two people from the queue and match them to start the game. So it's on a first come first basis. So the first player gets assigned to the second player. And that's how the matches are created. So that's this part. So I basically put him into a queue. Then I fire an event to see if there are enough players to start the game. And I basically increment the number of players. I'll tell you why this is needed. Then I tell everybody that I send them statistics. So I send them statistics like these are the number of players that are present and these are the number of games that have been started. So if you want to send data to everybody who is connected, you can just say io.sockets.emit. So that will send data to everybody that is connected. There are also other ways to send data to the client. So the commented out part here. So socket.broadcast.emit will send data to everybody who is connected, apart from the person who initiated connection. So it's like client A, B, C, all of these three connect. And you do socket.broadcast.emit. And at that point, if client C was getting connected, the data will only go to client A and client B. Client C will be left out. And if you want to send data only to a particular client, you can do socket.emit. So that way you send data only to the particular client. So in the context of the game, what we are actually sending, the data that we are sending is, the one thing is, I have the game, so you obviously have to send moves to the players. So that is one data that is being sent. Then there is chat. So people can chat between others. So that is the other kind of data that we send. The third kind of data that we send is statistics. How many players are there, how many games have been started. Very basic trivial stuff.
Just a question. What's different than IO sockets and socket.broadcast?
So IO.sockets, so socket is the client that is actually connecting.
Mm-hmm.
And io.sockets is every client that they ever connected.
Yeah, so when I say socket.broadcast, it basically means that we'll be doing the same thing like io.sockets.
No, so the difference between those two is, suppose client A, B, C and connecting in this order.
Mm-hmm.
A after B, then C client connects. So if you do socket.broadcast.emit, since C, client C is connecting at that point, the data only goes to client A and client B.
Okay.
Client C doesn't get the data.
But in case of io.sockets, it will go to everybody.
So this same statement can be done in this. So if I uncomment these two lines, it's the same effect. So I send data to the first client that connected, the last client that got connected, and the others. So I'm using the built-in message type for chatting. So whenever user chats with other user, the message is sent between them. And move is whenever we make a move, the other person knows about it. and disconnect is obviously when a player disconnects, the other people have to be notified of. We actually don't notify the other sockets, but we could notify the other sockets. What we just do is update the statistics of the number of players connected or not. So this is the socket IO code that essentially needs to be written. So to write a simple server using socket IO, it's probably less than 10 lines of code that you need to write. Since we have a little complex game, it's not very complex, a little complex game, so just little more lines of code.
So your match is an event which you are editing?
Yeah, match is the event that we are passing.
That's what match does?
So it's a custom event that you have written. What it does is, it tries to look into the queue to see if there are enough players to start a game with. And so, on a broad level, these are the two things. You do socket.on, which means you listen for that event. Socket.emit is you emit that event to the other person. So these are the two things. So when two players are matched, we do socket.emit already, which means we are ready to start the game. And here if you see socket.on is when we are listening for those events. So I'm running the server here. So whenever a client connects, we'll actually see what is happening. I've not put a lot of prints here, so I guess there's way too much information here. Probably understand anything. Let's forget that. So these are the basic things. Then there's something else called a room in socket.io. So the point of rooms is, so if you don't have rooms, what happens is everybody gets to know what are the information. Suppose we have a game and we don't have rooms, so everybody will participate in a single game. So when you make a move, everybody comes to know of the game. So that's what happens when you don't have rooms. So in socket.io, they also have this capability called a room. So you can actually join two players to a room. It's like a channel, it's like a private channel. And whenever you send data to the channel, everybody in the channel gets the data. So that's what is a room in socket.io. And the way to do that is, we're actually doing it here. So once enough players are present in the game, we actually match the players into a room. So room is a simple integer that I keep incrementing. It can be anything. For simplicity's sake, it's just a number that is getting incremented. So whenever two players are matched, the room number is incremented. And that's how I also keep track of the number of games that have been started. So once you join two players or multiple players to a room, you can actually emit data to that room. The way to send data to the room is socket.broadcast.to. So data.id is a room number or the room name, and then you emit what data type it is and what data it is. That's pretty much it. If you are interested, actually you can log into the app and play for yourself.
I have a question. Does socket.io give you any help with dealing with like race conditions? Like for example, let's say you're making a game where two cars are racing. So specifically what time, the exact moment that you make those actions are important. Uh-huh. But considering like latency and the fact that you won't get a reliable timestamp from the browser. Okay. Does socket.io help you or do you have to like build in the logic by yourself?
Socket.io doesn't provide you.
So it just provides the messaging interface.
Yeah, it only provides the messaging interface. Okay. So you have to take care of the latency and all
that.
So when you said when a browser doesn't support
WebSockets.
It falls back to other stuff. Do you need to write any extra code for that or does it automatically take
it? It automatically takes care of it. So it's a very simple API. It exposes these APIs and you don't have to worry about the underlying transport. Okay. It automatically takes care of it.
And what about support for mobile devices?
Yeah, mobile also works. So the latest browsers support WebSocket. I think iOS 5 probably supports. So the previous ones at least support Ajax, which means they'll also work.
Can the client be used with other server-side bindings like for PHP or Python?
Yeah, it can be used if they understand the protocol.
So are there libraries for like Python and?
I'm not sure. But it's again a protocol that they have implemented. So if any client implements a protocol, yeah, it will work. But the duty is you can actually write code on the client and the server. And in some cases, you can actually share code between the client and the server.
But isn't there an overhead with running a PHP and Node.js?
Yeah, it is probably there. But what you could actually do is you could have a server which just takes care of notifications alone. So that way it actually scales very nicely. And the way PHP works is it is process based. Node.js is obviously callback based. So it supports a lot of connections. And another note about Socket.io. So whatever data is present is stored in memory. So whatever data it needs to maintain, it stores in memory. So like the data like room number, number of players, all that is stored in memory. So what you could do is if you want to scale to multiple processes, which means you want to scale to multiple servers, you would want to share this data across multiple processes and servers. So it also has other stores, so you can actually use Redis for that instance. You can store the data in Redis and it can be shared across all those processes. That also can be.
Can I use Node as my socket client? Like, can I actually interact between two Node servers using sockets themselves? Well, let's say I have two servers running and I want to communicate between them.
Okay.
Instead of HTTP, I want to use WebSockets. How difficult would Socket.io help me with something like that?
Yeah, so, okay, the beauty of Socket.io is you don't have to worry about what transport is being used.
Hmm.
So that way it will use whatever is available, but you can actually force Socket.io to use only specific transports. You can say that if it doesn't support any of the other things other than Socket, it won't work on this.
I think the question more like if I have let's say two server instances of Node.js running, and if I want to communicate between those two, is it possible in Node.js? But then Node.js itself has to work as a client and a server together.
So from the client, you want to connect, talk to two different servers.
No, I want the servers to talk amongst each other.
Yeah, it is possible.
Without exposing an HTTP API.
Does it work
over
TCP?
Essentially, yeah.
Yeah, it should work. You can create sockets.
Any other questions? So I have some questions. I tried yesterday night and there was some message, like RBIT message on the console.
Okay.
What are they? I mean, it's like the socket is to send like regularly some message, right?
Which one?
Yeah.
RBIT. Okay, so RBIT is a way for the server to know whether the client is alive or not.
Okay.
So a lot of times what happens is the client may not send a dispatch even because of multiple reasons, like the internet connection got cut or something like that. So to know whether the client exists or not, is alive or not, so server keeps sending a heartbeat. And actually all these can also be configured on the socket server.
What is the right timing?
I think it's 60 seconds or 2 minutes.
Okay. And last question. Did you have to solve this problem with authentication?
Authentication. Did you have to do that? Or? No, I didn't have to do that, but Socket.io apparently supports a way to authorize and handshake.
Okay.
I haven't done it in depth, but it is possible.
Okay, so thank you, Ram.
So
we do a short break if you want to.